251, He Lives. And aren't we thankful He lives?
He lives, He lives.
Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along this narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. Yes, clear my mind, He lives. He lives within my heart.
Dan Tierney will now, time is your Dan. I don't see you here, but time is yours.
All right. Good. Welcome. Happy Sabbath, everyone. I just wanted to welcome you all to Three Angels Church and pray that it will be a blessing for you today, that you're, that we can all worship together. Just a couple of announcements for the schedule this week. We have Vespers tonight at 6:30. And then tomorrow morning, for those involved, we have an elders meeting at 9 and a church board meeting at 10. And then we have the midweek service at 7 o'clock on Wednesday that you're all welcome to. And the links are all on the website, the church website, and we hope you can make it to these. Thank you.
It's Esther now who will continue our song service. Okay. Esther and Rose.
Our next song is Blessed Assurance. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior, happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness.
Our next song is actually the opening song for our church service. Dan Tierney is our speaker today, and he picked this song, Faith is the Victory. The title of his message today is, since you don't have a bulletin, I will share that with you, A Great Cloud of Witnesses. So again, Faith is the Victory. This song that we'll be singing now will be taking us into the church service. We'll go live on the radio during this song. So go ahead, Esther and Rose, let's lead us in this song. Faith is the Victory. I'd like to welcome all of you to the Three Angels Seventh-day Adventist Church church service here in Wichita, Kansas. Some of you are joining us right now via radio. Others have joined us on YouTube. Others will be listening in or watching this later in the week, maybe this afternoon. We're thankful that you all are able to participate in our church service. You know, we are a church and we are meeting. Some have asked me, Pastor, when are we going to come together as a church again? And you know what? We are actually coming together weekly, several times a week as a church. There have been some concerns about not meeting, and I sent a letter to all of you, all the church members, should have gotten an email. Those of you who have emails, if you haven't received an email about our reasoning as a church board and as elders in terms of our the process forward, I invite you to go to YouTube to, where we have the Three Angels Church, not YouTube. You can go to YouTube, but also go to Facebook, if you have Facebook, to the church's Facebook channel. And there is a 10-minute video there that I posted, I think, yesterday or the day before yesterday, where I read through the letter explained a few things about what's happening in terms of the process forward. Now, it so happened that just a few hours after I sent the letters out to the church members regarding the process forward, our president came out and mentioned that all the churches should be able to open. Now, I want you to be aware of the fact that as a church, we will look into what is best for three angels. We have a specific, we have specific needs in this church, and that we have to be considerate towards, and people that are have special needs. And so our process may not be identical to many other churches. There are many churches that are not opening today. You know, churches are not beholden to any political party, Democrat or Republican. We're answering to God, and we have to make sure that what we do is the right thing for our church. We have a mission that will hopefully be a mission towards reaching all people. And we do not want to alienate people unnecessarily by being spreading the wrong kind of thing, especially not a bad virus. And so, yes, we will keep you informed. And we're meeting weekly as elders and even church board. We met last week. We're meeting again tomorrow because this is a situation that is rather fluid. So we will let you know as soon as we know more. About tomorrow, tomorrow we have a 12:30 p.m. Memorial service via Zoom. One of our church members, Subira. Subira is from Tanzania. Subira comes from a large family in Tanzania. Two of her sisters, during the past 2 weeks, passed away. 3 weeks. There were 2 weeks between their deaths. The first one passed away from the coronavirus. And the second, you might say, you may want to correct me if I'm wrong, Subira, but it seems like the second one passed away from a broken heart. I don't know any more than that, that she was grieving the loss of her sister and so forth. But I don't know any more details. Maybe Subira will share that with us tomorrow as we meet at 12:30. I want to invite you to join in. We can have up to 300 people on Zoom, and the link will be on the church website. So you can go there, find the link for 12:30 p.m. tomorrow afternoon and join us. There will be people joining us from Africa. You know, there are no limitations when you have Zoom. So we encourage you to be a part of that. Again, I'm so glad that we have the patience of the saints, right? I pray that we'll continue to have that patience as we go forward, and that we will meet when we are ready to meet as a church, but in our church facility. But again, we are a church, we are meeting and on a regular basis. We look forward to be able to shake hands. Maybe we can't, hopefully we will rub shoulders again soon. And so at this time, I want to invite Dr. Bryant, Kevin Bryant. He's our head elder at Three Angels Church. I want to invite him to lead us. He will be sharing the children's story at this time. Kevin?
Okay. All right. Well, the children's story today is for children ages 1 to 100. So it's for everyone. Most children's stories have a point or a moral that's good for everyone of any age. This story is called The Lighthouse Children, and it took place a number of years ago at a lighthouse on the northern shore of Lake Superior. And Mrs. Bryant and I had the opportunity several years ago to visit this lighthouse. And I don't know if you can see this on the screen. That is the lighthouse. It's called Split Rock Lighthouse. It's set beautifully on the top of a high rock cliff overlooking Lake Superior, and just gorgeous lighthouse. Mm-hmm. And this story took place there many years ago. And the lighthouse, you know, most lighthouses are placed there because of shipwrecks that have happened. And so someone says, we need a lighthouse there. And that's how this one got there. And, you know, the light turns all night long, grows brighter, then fainter, brighter, fainter. And ships that pass by are in the night are able to sail safely into the harbor because they can see that light and they know where they are, and they know where the dangerous rocks are and so forth. So the captains love to see that light. And, you know, whether it's winter or summer, whether it's storming or calm, the light is always on each night. And the darker the night is, the more bright that light will shines across, you know, whether it's a terrible tempest or not. So anyway, in this lighthouse many years ago lived a lighthouse keeper family, a man and his wife, and there were two children. One was Paul and the other daughter was Renee. Now, like most lighthouse families, their life is really a very kind of strange life. They basically, lighthouse keeper families are in lockdown for years because no one comes to see them. They are completely isolated usually. Anyway, one evening as dusk was falling, the father climbed up the steep, narrow staircase as he had done for so many times in the past to kindle the light. And in just a few moments, though, he returned back down and he was looking pale and sick. And he collapsed into a chair and said, "I am ill. I am sick." And mother ran over to him in deep distress. And she could see that he was seriously ill. And there was confusion. The children were standing by, anxious and worried. And after a little while, mother had gotten the father put into bed because he was so sick. Well, Paul spoke up and he says, "Mother, what about the light?" And so she said, "Go and see." She says, "I can't go now." So Paul and Renee both crept softly out of the room, climbed up this cold, dark staircase. Night had fallen by that time. There was a storm blowing up. Dark clouds were scudding across the pale moon, and the waves were beginning to become bigger and bigger, and the spray was hissing as it curled back into the raging sea. Well, the light was burning, but there was something wrong. Over the sea, they could see it was just all darkness. The light was pointing towards the land. Suddenly, Paul cried, "Renee, the shade is not turning. The ships will not see the light. What shall we do?" You know, lighthouses have this shade that turns around to direct the light in all different directions. And so the shade was not turning. And so Renee said, "Well, can you start the machinery?" And he says, "I'll try." And Paul had seen his father do it many times, thought he could do it now, but soon he found that there was something seriously the matter. Something had gone wrong. The machine was broken and he could not get it started. "What shall we do?" cried Renee. "Well, there is a hand wheel," said Paul, "but you could not turn that alone. This hand wheel is this huge 6-foot diameter cogwheel wheel with handles, one on each side that you could turn manually, but it was just too big for one person, one boy to do that. So seizing the great handle, they both began to turn it, one on each side. The shade began to move. They were glad the ships would see the light after all. Well, hour after hour, they toiled on. And no night had ever seemed so long. Their arms grew tired, their hands became sore and blistered. Minutes seemed like hours, hours seemed like days. And outside, the storm broke and raged in fury around them. And below, their father was very ill, and mother was busy taking care of him. But still, these children of the light kept turning, turning, turning the wheel. In utter weariness, they carried on until a faint gray light in the east told them that their task was done. Well, the captains that night saw the light and thanked God for it, but they never knew what was happening in the lighthouse or the heroism of those two little children who were faithful to their trust. So just as Paul and Renee kept that light turning through that long stormy night, so God wants his children, age 1 to 100, to keep the light of his love shining out into the dark, troubled world. The darker everything is around us, the more brightly our light should be. Nothing should be allowed to put it out. There are many people around us like ships passing who are looking for the guidance and friendliness that we can give them. So we who are children of the light must keep it burning through the night. And that's the end of my children's story. Blessings.
Thank you for sharing that story. Elaine Marching has been the teacher for the Three Angels Church School for how many years, Elaine? I know that you are the one that will be sharing the offering appeal. How many years have you been our teacher now?
11.
11 years. And this is the last year officially as the main teacher. And you just wrapped up a school year, didn't you?
Yes.
Yeah. And as who would have thought it would have happened in this way, via Zoom?
Right.
But it's been a blessing, I think, even with Zoom, right?
Right.
Yeah. Well, we're looking forward to I wouldn't say a farewell, because she's going to stay at Three Angels and she will continue to work at the school in this coming year. But we do have another teacher coming in the beginning of June. We have two teachers for the price of one. We are so thankful that we have had a quality teacher all these years. And also thankful that we have a new teacher coming in who found a home for themselves and they're ready to move in. And so Elaine, I know that your husband is a treasure for the church, so you are sitting on some inside information. Maybe not, but you are here to share with us about the financial needs and also give the offering appeal to our church family. It's an act of worship, isn't it? So go ahead, yes.
Okay, happy Sabbath. Our offering today is for the local conference advance. Thursday, I watched a webinar about our new mass series. And one thing that they brought out that's very unique about the new mass series is that it does, on any of the word problems, it doesn't say Sam or Marvin or Kevin or anybody else. It says you. So this morning I'm going to use the same process. I want you to think about how much you gave for each of the offerings for church. Back in 1980, it was suggested for a Sabbath school mission offering that you gave just $1. Now, would that be the same today? Would you still just give $1? Or if you were thinking of your tithe, do you give the same amount as what you gave like in 1980? No, because you would give 10%. On your tithe envelope, makes a suggestion of what percent to give to conference advance. I challenge you to not just necessarily think of it as being a percentage that you have to give, but you are giving back to God what he has already given you. And so today, don't just think about what we need as a church, but also as our conference, because this also helps not only our camps, which we're not having this year, but it also helps our church school then, because for each student that is enrolled at the beginning of the year, we receive $300 for each student. So think about that. And also we do have a student that's on a scholarship from the conference. So we receive funds from our conference in many of those ways. So today, as you prayerfully give your offering, send it by in the mail, or if you give it to one of the elders as they come around, or you do it as online giving, which we have seen a great increase there, and we're very thankful for that. Ask God to help you know exactly how much you should be giving. And we thank you for your generosity.
Let us pray. Dear loving Heavenly Father, we're thankful for your faithfulness, that you have gone all out to save us, that you have given everything to meet our deepest need. And of course, our greatest need is to become more and more like Jesus and to experience the joy and the peace that only you can give. Father, we're thankful for the faithfulness of your people, because it's your spirit that brings that about. We're thankful for the funds that have come in on a regular basis, even during this crisis time when we're meeting via Zoom, which has kept the church going, because the church is so much more than a building. And thank you, Father, that you provide for all of our needs. Father, we have a special concern for those who are struggling with various situations, crisis in their lives. I'm thinking of those who are lost jobs and they don't know where to turn to make ends meet. I pray, Father, that you will be close to them, especially those among us who have lost jobs. We pray, Father, for those who have health issues in our midst, those who are struggling with whether it be the coronavirus or any other illness. Help them, Father, to sense your presence, and I pray for healing in their lives, whether it is emotional or physical or spiritual healing that is needed. Father, you know what is needed. And so we ask for your will to be done. I pray for Subira and her family, Father, as they're grieving the loss of two of Subira's sisters. Be near to them and help them to sense your presence and to sense the warmth and the love of those around them who are grieving with them. I pray that you will comfort them and help them to keep their eyes on the future. I'm thankful, Father, that Subira's family is a Christian family. And I'm thinking of others, Father, that may be in similar situations that we are not aware of. I pray, Father, that you will, your spirit will be in every home and strive with every heart among us, that we may have a close walk with Jesus and look to Jesus in the midst of any kind of situation we may find ourselves in. I pray for a new teacher moving in, Father, that you will help there to be a seamless transition in our school, that the two teachers will work well together, and that when this new school year starts, that they will be able to meet in our building. Father, finally, I also pray for the reopening of our church, that you will give wisdom to the elders and the church board as we lay out plans, as we are preparing for what will happen. We don't know exactly when, that we will meet every need, that we will not reopen the church unsafely, but that we will keep in mind the weakest among us. So give us wisdom for that. And we pray now, Father, also for our speaker today, one of our elders, Dan Cheney, that you will speak through him, that the message he has been given by you, it will be one that touches hearts, and that each of us will be blessed. Again, we thank you that you are our Lord and our Savior, that you have a plan and a purpose for each of our lives as we give ourselves over to you with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our strength, with all our mind. Thank you, Father, for the future you have. Thank you that we can lean on you in all kinds of situations, and that you have each one of us, our names, tucked close to your heart. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Esther will now have special music. Esther Byrol, accompanied by her mother. No, are you singing a cappella?
No, I have my piano right here.
Oh, so I didn't see it.
The sound comes through just fine. If you would permit me, I'd like to tell you the story about this song. This song, I was 17 years old, and I was visiting some friends over in California. And while I was there, I got the call that my grandfather passed away, my dad's dad. And the whole family was going over to North Carolina for his funeral, and I was stuck in California, and I wasn't able to go. And I felt very sad about that. And I remember just when I finally was able to go home, I was so sad, and I was crying. And it was so dreary that day. It was raining. It was horrible and miserable. And I was thinking, you know, this is just how I feel. It's just so dark and dreary down here. And my heart is dark and dreary. And then the plane took off and it started to climb. And we got above the clouds. And then it was so bright, I had to put my sunglasses on because the sun was reflecting on the clouds and was reflecting back up into my eyes, and it was so bright up there. And I realized that even though sometimes it may seem dark down here, we have to remember the sun's still shining up above the clouds, and that it's not dark up there, and that God wants us to lift us up out of our pain, out of our sorrow, out of our misery, and take us up where it's bright and sunshiny, and where we can feel God's love. And so that's what this song is about. I pray that the sound comes through, but I wanted to let you know what it was about.
So he wants to take us to a place where we have to put our sunglasses on, right?
That's right. It's so bright and so beautiful that we have to put our sunglasses on.
Amen.
This world can seem so dark sometimes. I long for something more. When I look around at all the pain, I wonder, can we get past the clouds? Can we rise above the clouds, where we can't see the darkness below us? If we clasp God's hand and let him lift us from our pain, he'll lead us up through the sky. Looking back, there were many hard times, but I was never alone. Jesus held my hand through all the pain, and he helped me to get past the clouds. Can we rise above the clouds, where we can't see the darkness below us? If we clasp God's hand and let him lift us from our pain, lead us up through the sky. 'Cause every dark cloud has a silver lining. We just have to get above.
Amen. What a blessing. What a blessing. Thank you for that song. Dan, it is your message now that we look forward to hearing.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Welcome again, and thank you for being here. And I just wanted to open my sermon with a quick prayer. Father, we pray that you would fill me with your Spirit, that the words that I speak would be your words and that would give the message that you want to give. We thank you, Lord, and we come in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, so if you have your Bibles, you can open to Hebrews, because that's where we'll spend most all of our time, is in Hebrews. The text associated with today's message is Hebrews 12, verse 1. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Now, the first part of 12:1 there is, we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. Now, I looked up that word cloud, and it says to lie all around, or to enclose, or encircle, or hamper, to be bound with. I thought that last one was kind of interesting. So this, the witnesses that we have around us are to enclose us, completely encircle us. They're all around us. We can't get away from them. And just like a cloud, when you're up in a cloud, when you're up in a plane, until you get above the plane, like Esther was talking about, until you see it, that all you're surrounded by is clouds. And so, and then witness is the word martus, which is where they get martyr from. And it's like you'd think of a witness, like in a jury, you'd have a witness, and or a record or a martyr, whatever they're doing, and that is the witness. And so the 12:1 starts with therefore. So I'm going to take a quick look at what he says before therefore, so we can see what it relates to. I'm going to take a quick tour through Hebrews, pointing out a few high points, and then we'll get down to chapter 11, where I'll cover in a little more detail, and then get on into 12. So if we start at Hebrews 1:1, God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son. So it talks, and then Hebrews goes on to talk about God's great word to man, how he's given his word to man, and that we should take heed. Hebrews 2:1 says, therefore, we must give the most earnest heed to the things we have heard, from the witnesses, lest we drift away. So as we see what the witnesses are telling us, we need to take heed to what they're saying. Hebrews goes on to talk about earth as under the subject of man, which is talking about Jesus. Jesus, who was for a little while humiliated so that he could become our high priest, talks about the danger of unbelief. Then Hebrews 3:12 says, "Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God." So that implies endurance, not to fall away, not to get distracted. So we need to have endurance. And then Hebrews goes on talking about the believer's true rest. 4:15 says, "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in times of need." And this would be pointing back to the demonstration by the witnesses. What did they do? How can we learn from what they've done? So it goes on to talk about Jesus as the perfect high priest, the perils of falling away, that there are better things for believers, the certainty of God's promises. Then it talks about Christ and Melchizedek and his better ministry. Then it talks about the new covenant, Hebrews 8:10. "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God and they shall be my people." So again, this is talking about the promise, the ultimate promise that we're all looking forward to, the ultimate promise that needs to happen before the end of time so that we can all go home. He needs to put his law in our hearts and our minds. And we shall be his people. So this is the promise he's given us. And so then it talks about the old and the new covenant, the Christ's all-sufficient sacrifice, and the dangers of turning back. So let's go to Hebrews 10:36, and we'll slow down a little bit. So as we've seen, this is talking about Christ's ministry, trying to explain to the Hebrews about Christ being the high priest and his all-sufficient sacrifice and it also gives warnings about turning back or falling away. So Hebrews 36:10 is kind of a good summary of some of that. It says, "For we have need of endurance, so that after we have done the will of God, we may receive the promise." So again, we need endurance, and then we need to do the will of God, and then we may receive the promise. And so once we do that, after we endure and we've done the will of God and we received his promises, then it says, "For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul." So here is talking about the promises of his coming. Now we, as Adventists, believe that his coming is soon, very soon. If you look at Daniel 11, we've just got a few verses left at the end of Daniel 11 before the judgment starts, which is the start of chapter 12. Revelations, we're in the three angels' messages. The next thing talks about the judgment. So we're close to the end, you know, and we have to have that faith that Jesus had, and we have to not draw back. We have to be, have to endure, get to the end. And so then Paul starts talking about the faith chapter, and we get into that was just before chapter 11. So that was kind of the lead in to chapter 11. So now 11 goes through several Old Testament patriarchs talking about how about their testimony. It says, verse 1 says, by faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So faith is our hoping, our excitement about what's coming, about the evidence of things not seen. How many of us have seen the second coming? None of us, because it hasn't happened yet. So it's the end. But how many of us have lots of evidence that the second coming is near? And we'll get into that a little bit later. But so as we have faith, it's hope. And as we look at the evidence, as we see the evidence and the witnesses around us, for by it, which is faith, the elders obtained a good testimony. So they obtained their testimony by faith. By the faith they show, and just like James says, faith without works is dead. So our faith needs to be shown in our works. So by faith, we understand, or verse 3, by faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things that were not made of, that were not made of things which are visible. So we know that the world was created 6,000 years ago, and we have faith that it happened because we can see the evidence around us. I mean, if you look at the evidence of geology, depending on your mindset, you'll see one of two things. You'll see creation or evolution. I mean, and it's all, most of it's based on what you want to see, frankly. And if you really look at the evidence, it really shows more toward a worldwide flood rather than the millions of years. But we'll leave that for others to discuss. You have the faith of Abel, who offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. So as Abel offered the sacrifice that showed his faith that someday God would send someone, would send his son to take away our sins, the Messiah, then he showed that faith by doing the right thing, by sacrificing the lamb which represented Jesus. And then Cain, who showed his lack of faith by sacrificing his own works, the things he had created through his garden, from his garden. And so we see that we have, you know, Abel was a witness for God. Enoch, he pleased God. Verse 5, verse 6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please him. For we who come to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Now, we must believe that he is. Can we? Do we have enough witness, enough evidence that he exists? Of course we do. We have prophecies and other things. We have how he works in people's lives and many other things that show that he is there. He is, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. You can see that through all the stories of the Bible. Those who sought him were rewarded. Those who did not seek him were not rewarded. And so going on, we talk about Noah, who was warned of things not yet seen, but moved with godly fear, preparing an ark to save his household. So he, even though he had never seen rain, knew it was, feared God, and he moved with godly fear. He said, okay, he says it's going to rain. I believe him. I'm going to build a boat. And Abraham talks about Abraham going out to a country, to a place he never even knew. He didn't even know where it was at. And in dwelling in tents, I mean, he could have built a city, but he decided that it wasn't what he wanted, because he was waiting for a city with foundations whose builder and maker was God, verse 10. So he was waiting for God's city, and And then it talks about Sarah and her faith. And then verse 13, these all died in faith, not having received the promise, but having seen them afar off. But having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. So again, Abraham did that just because he lived in tents. He didn't have a set city. He didn't build a city like it was a permanent residence. He lived in tents. And so they all, by faith, not having received the promises, were looking forward to the promises. And so they all were part of the witnesses. Verse 16, but now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. So they were waiting for God's city, and they believed that he was going to prepare it for them. They were waited for it, and they all passed away still waiting for it. And then it talks about how Abraham was tested with Isaac, and when he had to sacrifice Isaac, and how he believed that God could raise Isaac up. Then it talks about Isaac and Jacob and Joseph. Moses goes through several verses about Moses. And then, interesting, the last one that it covers with some sort of description is not one of the patriarchs, but a harlot from Jericho who didn't even worship God, but she believed because she had seen all the witness of what had happened to the Hebrews over the past 40 years. They came 40 years earlier, and with the spy situation, they had to go back into the desert for 40 years. And so she, you know, if she was older than 40, had heard all those stories and had witnessed them. And so she had all this evidence, this witness that they were God's people and that God did exist. Then it goes through several others. And then verse 33, it starts talking about some of the trials that different people went through, most of which were required trials that people don't like to go through. For example, subduing kingdoms requires war. Nobody likes war. Quenching the violence of fire or shutting the mouths of lions is probably talking about Daniel and the lion's den. And then the three getting thrown into the fiery furnace. And it goes through several other things there, talking about how they're those witnesses went through troubles just like we have to go through, and they all made it out at the other end with faith still and not giving up on the promises. And all these, having obtained the good testimony through faith, did not receive the promises. I'm reading verse 39, sorry. God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. So what does that mean? That means that they were not made perfect until we used them as witnesses. Their trials occurred to benefit them, but also for our benefit. And so as we talk about different witnesses, we've looked at all these witnesses that Paul went through in Hebrews, and there are many other witnesses besides those. We think of New Testament. We have the New Testament witnesses, the Apostolic Church, all the stories from the New Testament. We have the Time of Trouble witnesses, like the Anabaptists, the Waldenses, and several others. We have the Reformation witnesses, like Luther and Huss, and then we have a Revelation talks about the two witnesses, which are the Old and New Testament. So we have those. We have the witness of prophecy. Now, when Daniel gave the prophecy 2,500 years ago, was it a witness then? Not particularly, because it hadn't been fulfilled. It was telling what was going to happen, but until it's fulfilled, it's not a witness, not that much of a witness. So as, you know, just like as the Jews saw the 490 years coming to a close and were anticipating Jesus, they hoped it was the witness, they prayed it was the truth, but they didn't know till Jesus came that the prophecy was fulfilled. And so just like all the prophecies have with the 2300 days coming down to our times, all those have been fulfilled except for the last few verses in Daniel 11. And so we've seen all this, we've had all this witness of not only the prophecies, but the fulfillment of the prophecies. We have the Advent Awakening witnesses, we have the early church witnesses, and we have the witnesses today. Each of us is a witness to others around us. And there, you know, up to now, we've been talking about mainly witnesses, positive witnesses, you might say, but there are also negative witnesses, people who do the wrong thing and have things happen to them that help us learn not to do the wrong things. So as people do things and see that their witness, or as people do things, the consequences of what they do are the witness for what they do. So now going back to Hebrews 12:1, therefore we also, since we are surrounded with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and who sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Now, if you keep reading through Hebrews 12, it says, verse 3 says, for consider him, Jesus, how Jesus endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin, and you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. My son, do not despise the chastening or discipline of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. So as we grow, as we see witnesses around us, we see what they've done, then it's a lesson to us that we can learn in one of two ways. We can, verse 6 says, for whom the Lord loves, he chastens. Now that word chastens just means train up a child, educate, discipline, instruct, learn, teach. So it's talking about, you know, when your conscience convicts you, that's chastening. When you listen to a sermon that maybe hits at something that you're doing wrong, that's chastening. When the pastor or elders talk to you, that's chastening. Those are simple. I don't want to say simple. They're early chastening, you might say. They're chastening that happens to help you learn something without having to go through the second one, which is, and scourges. It says, for the Lord who loves, he chastens and scourges. So if you don't listen to the chastening, you get the scourges. And scourges are just what they sound like, scourges. Flogging is what it means in the original language. And, you know, that could be something much more severe, like, you know, you may have to go to prison because of what you do in order for God to get your attention. You may have to have an injury or an illness in order for God to get your attention. And so, but remember the last part there says, every son whom he, wait, okay, I guess I have to read the whole thing. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. So he does that because we're his children. and he wants us to grow and be ready for heaven. Kind of watching my time here. Let's see. Okay. Therefore, strengthen the hand. 12:12 says, therefore, strengthen the hand. Oh, wait, let me start at 11. Now, no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterwards, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So as he chastens us, we're to be trained by it, whether it's the chastening or the scourging. We're to be trained by it. And then verse 12 says, therefore, strengthen your hands which hang down. Now, this verse and the next verse talk about what we should do to be healed. So when your hands are hanging down, are you doing anything? No. So it says, strengthen the hands that hang down. They're weak, they're not doing anything, so you have to do something. He says, do something for me. And then he says, and the feeble knees, don't be scared. You know, to me, feeble knees make me think of shaking knees. So don't be scared to do something. And then verse 13 says, and make straight your paths, make straight paths for your feet, which means don't turn away from what you know is right. Said, don't turn to the left, to the right, or around, or anything else. Just keep going on the path you know is the right one. So that what is lame may not be dislocated, but rather be healed. So that as we keep going down that path, as we keep doing things, as we put away the fear or go through the fear, might be another way to say it, he heals us through those things. And then it starts going through some things. Example says, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Let's see. So we shouldn't despise his gifts. And then just continues talking about how we've gone to... we should go to Mount Zion and be blessed by God as we are accepted into his family. Then chapter 13 talks about some other examples. Says brotherly love, verse 1, brotherly love. Verse 2, entertain strangers, remember the prisoners. Consider marriage as an honorable institution that God created. Verse 5, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So as we, you know, even going through this coronavirus stuff, we should be content with what we have. Because he's with us. He says, I will never leave you. He's given you a promise that if we continue and in this case, particularly not be covetous, then he will be with us and he will provide for us. And then verse 6, it says, so we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? So remember those, and then it talks about remembering those who rule over you. Do not be carried about in various and strange doctrines, verse 9. And then verse 15, let's jump down to 14. We'll start with 14. For here we have no continuing city, but we seek the one to come. Therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifices of praise to God, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But do not forget to do good and to share. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. So what are the sacrifices that God wants from us? Seek the city to come. Verse 15 there says, sacrifice of praise. So praise God for what he's doing. Give thanks to him. And then verse 16 says, do good and share. None of this is real hard. But that's the praises he wants. That's the sacrifice he wants us, is just to praise him, give thanks to him, and to do good and share. And again, it talks about obeying those who rule over you. And you can read through that. Let's see. Okay, so now going back to verse 12:1, it says, what our scripture for the day says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. So again, we're surrounded. We're completely engulfed by all the witnesses around us. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance. So that's the endurance, laying aside the sin. And keep have that endurance to race and run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him. Now, when he was carrying out when he was being sacrificed, did he have the promises yet? Or the joy that was set before him, were they still promises? I guess is the way I should ask it. Were they still promises? Yeah, they were still promises to him. They were still stuff in the Bible. They were still from his father. He said, if you sacrifice, there will be joy. You'll have the joy of spending eternity with all those you saved. So to him, it was still a promise. And so we are surrounded by the cloud of witnesses. We need to endure and listen to those cloud of witnesses. And then we need to do it because we're looking forward to the joy that he has set before us, which is eternity in heaven. So let us all remember the many witnesses all around us. And to close, I will read the benediction that Paul put in his letter, which is Hebrews 13, 20 and 21. So shall we pray? Father, may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do his will, working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight. Through Christ Jesus, to whom be glory forever and ever.